That's right, it's KP's Video News, y'all. I'm coming to you real. Coming to you with the real. That's right, folks. Coming to you with the news that you... Coming to you with the news, not the blues. Yep. Yeah, folks, I'm a... yesterday, I missed the show yesterday because technical difficulties. Man. It's like one thing after another, after another, after another. And so I just shut it down. I said, wait a minute. Let me start over. Sometimes that's what you got to do, man. You got to shut it down and live to fight another day. That's right. You know, then, you know, all you youngsters out there trying to pretend like you all hard. Ain't nothing wrong with running. Yep, run today. You'll live to see tomorrow. I'm happy, you know, just looking at this story. It's, you know, it's been on the wire for a couple of days, and I'm going to do it today, because like I said, I was having technical difficulties yesterday. And what it has to do with the Snoop Diggity Dog Dizzle. Snoop Dogg acquires Death Row Records. Okay, got rapper, entrepreneur Snoop, who rose to fame during the 1990s on Death Row Records, has acquired the label brand from MNRK Music Group, which is controlled by private equity funds managed by the investment firm Blackstone. The firm announced on Wednesday. Terms of the transition were not disclosed. However, a source close to the situation states that Snoop's acquisition of Death Row brand is the first step of a transition that is expected to see him also acquiring some of the label's music rights, his own and unspecified other artists. The source says the deal is expected to conclude in the coming weeks. The news comes just days before Snoop appears with Dr. Dre, Eminem, Mary J. Blige, and Kendrick Lamar during the Super Bowl halftime show on Sunday, and was foreshadowed earlier this week by the announcement that he and Nas are teaming up for a new song called Back on Death Row. Snoop is releasing a new album with the related title Back on Death Row on Friday. So, originally founded in 1992 by Suge Knight and Dick Griffey and rappers Dr. Dre and the DOC, in the wake of Dre's departure from NWA, Death Row went on to become one of the most successful, influential, and controversial record labels in the rap music industry. His roster included Dre, Snoop, Tupac, the DOC, Nate Dogg, Warren G, Michelle, and others. The label released several generation-defining albums, including Dre's The Chronic, Snoop's Doggy Style, Tupac's All Eyes on Me, but was marred by violence, some of which was instigated by Suge Knight, who has a long record of assault convictions and is currently serving a 28-year voluntary manslaughter sentence. The label began to unravel in the wake of Tupac's murder in 1996, which took place in a car Knight was driving in Las Vegas, and soon fell by the wayside as Nate's legal difficulties overtook him. He kept it going for several years before he and the label declared bankruptcy in 2006. It has changed hands several times over the years, with some major titles from his catalog moving to other labels. Primary in 1990s distributor Interscope. It was unclear at the time of the article's publication which title Snoop might be in the process of acquiring. In a statement, Snoop, now owner of Death Row Records, said, "I'm thrilled and appreciative of the opportunity to acquire the iconic, culturally significant Death Row Records brand, which has immense untapped future value. It feels good to have ownership of the label I was once part of at the beginning of my career and as one of the founding members. This is an extremely meaningful moment for me, and I would like to personally thank the teams at Blackstone, MNRK, and especially David Kestenbaum, who worked collaboratively with me over several months to make this exciting homecoming a reality. I'm looking forward to building the next chapter of Death Row Records. And congratulations, Snoop, on that, acquiring Death Row Records. And, you know, hey, it's really cool, man. It's really cool. And, you know, to see someone, man, just like you said, you're one of the people on the label, and then you one day you were able to acquire the label. That's just like my ancestors that were working on the sharecroppers on farms down in Missouri. Now the family owns those farms. So yeah, we own that. That's ours now. So if you can go from working for something to owning something, hey, that's right, own it. I tell you, you got to watch your back, because you know that it's whenever you do something good, there's always going to be those haters out there. And sure enough, not even a day later, after he acquired the record label, you have some lady comes along and says that Snoop and Bishop Don Juan, she's suing model, dancer, stripper, who demands under $10 million for an incident that occurred nearly a decade ago. Coming out the woodwork, here they come. They're coming out the woodwork already. So Snoop has responded to this new sexual harassment assault lawsuit filed by a woman who says she was a model and a dancer, stripper, was identified only as Jane Doe ahead of the Super Bowl halftime show performance. So drop it like it's hot. Rapper set aside his time to address the case on social media, taking to Instagram on Wednesday, February 9th. Snoop came out with a cryptic note that said, "Gold digger season is here." He said, he went on to add, "Be careful, nephews. Keep your guards up and keep your circle small." That's right. Keep your guards up and keep your circle small. Like I said, man, when you're doing good things, they come out the woodwork, man. They just come out the woodwork. Not even a day later. So Snoop, whose real name is Calvin Broadus Jr., is accused of forcing oral sex on a woman. Wow. In 2013, in the legal papers, and the woman who demanded under $10 million filed a suit, and just days prior to Snoop getting ready to perform at the Super Bowl on Sunday. So in the court documents, the woman claimed she saw Snoop perform in Anaheim in 2013, and the woman alleged that Bishop Don Juan, a longtime associate of Snoop, offered her a ride home after the event. The woman went on to say that she fell asleep in the car, and when she woke up, she found out that she had arrived at the Bishop's house instead of hers. Plaintiff said she was exhausted and fell asleep at Bishop Don Juan's home. Bishop then allegedly pulled out his Johnson from his pants and forced his Johnson into the plaintiff's face. It also said that Bishop Don Juan repeatedly slammed his Johnson into the plaintiff's mouth. When she awoke at 4 a.m., Bishop Don Juan discriminated against and harassed the plaintiff because the plaintiff's sex and gender, she insisted. The woman went on saying that the bishop later handed her a dress and instructed her to put it on so they can go to Snoop's studio. She claimed the bishop said one time, "I want to see if he's going to make you a weather girl on TV or something." Anyway, she admitted that she went to Snoop's studio but had stomach pain, so she went to the bathroom. And when she was in the bathroom, Snoop walked in on her standing with his with his crotch in the plaintiff's face. And she added that the hip hop star forced her to have oral sex with him. And after a few minutes, you know, the defendant withdrew his Johnson from the plaintiff's mouth, visibly unsatisfied with the plaintiff's reluctance and disgust by being forced to engage in oral sex. The complainant stated that the rapper allegedly to proceed to do other things, and then he reportedly allegedly said that I'll get you something to clean up with, and left. Shortly after, Bishop Don Juan came in, said, come here, take a picture with Snoop. And so in the lawsuit, the woman admitted that she was scared at the time before pointing out that Snoop didn't hire her because she refused to willingly and enthusiastically give him oral sex. Wow. Just a day later, telling you folks, can't make this stuff up, man. Just a day later, you got somebody coming out with the lawsuit, trying to hit him with the Cosby move. All right. Oh, well, the truth will come out, folks. Whether it was the real deal or not, the truth will come out in time. All right, here we go. We got a retired warden, traffic warrant, who called herself Gangsta Granny, has been convicted of drug dealing. Maureen Thompson from Greater Manchester began leading a double life as a drug dealer. She became addicted to cocaine following an injury, leading her to an early retirement. She says it cost her to rack up massive debts, which she paid off through dealing. 61-year-old was arrested after police raided her home and found 47 wraps of cocaine hidden in a sock and almost 400 grams of cutting agent inside a bin bag. Officers also recovered a debtors list and a notebook, as well as messages in her phone that related to numerous drug deals. According to the reports, the police seized, the amount of drugs seized was over $1,000. And despite the mounting evidence, Thompson denied any wrongdoing, telling officers that she had no idea where the drugs had come from. However, when she was eventually questioned, she was found to be wearing the same kind of socks that had been used to hide the cocaine. During a hearing, she admitted to charges of possession with intent to supply, as well as acquiring criminal property. In a statement, Thompson said that her drug habit had caused her to spiral into debt and led her to working for the dealer. She explained that she operated the phone for him and stored drugs at her house. And it was a substantial debt to a drug dealer, and I could not pay those debts, so I agreed to let the dealer use my account to deposit and withdraw drug money. And the debt continued to incur interest, and I agreed to store the drugs, to operate the drug phone for him. So anyway, she was a traffic enforcement officer for 28 years, and she has been convicted. And I don't know why anybody, she was using cocaine, claimed she was using cocaine to medicate herself, medicate herself because of pain issues. So I mean, they got doctors prescribed pills and stuff for that. So you decide you're going to use street drugs to help with your pain. That's not ever a smart idea or anything on that level, man. That's just stupid. Anyway, in a follow-up to a story I did the other day, it was a FedEx, I was telling you the other day about a FedEx driver that got chased by two guys down in Mississippi and was shot at. But this FedEx driver has filed a lawsuit, and, he was shot at, but after going through all that, when he contacted dispatcher, he said he was chased while making deliveries and was told by his supervisors to complete his route. even after the incident, and it's a 24-year-old driver, Montario Gibson, and say that the incidents happened on the eve of January 24th. He said he was shot at because the two white men thought he was suspicious. And he said he was wearing his FedEx uniform. And anyway, his lawyer said that Gibson made complaints to multiple supervisors, but they didn't show any concern. In fact, they wanted Gibson to do was complete his route after he almost lost his life. You have bullet fragments in the truck. And according to the video, and Diggs verified, and clearly someone that young that has dealt with this sort of shooting as it happened at Armand Arbery style is suffering from stress, for sure, PTSD. Referring to Arbery, a black man who was killed in a shooting after being chased by Gregory and Travis McMichaels, father and son. So you shouldn't require a young black male that just experienced racism at its highest height, seeing that Armand Arbery had got killed by two men that had chased and killed. Now you're telling him to finish his route. So when asked if Gibson was taking any action against FedEx for asking him to complete his route, and so they said they're still exploring legal options. And FedEx stated that it takes all these situations of this nature very seriously, and they're shocked by this criminal act against Gibson. And the safety of our team members is our top priority, and we remain focused on his well-being, said FedEx senior communications specialist. And wow. Yep. Gregory Case has been charged with conspiracy. The people in the case have been charged with conspiracy. Gregory Case and Brandon Case has been charged with aggravated assault. It should be charged with attempted murder. I don't know why they coming up with those weak charges, man. Real weak charges. So, you know, this is another one where you got this guy was shopping while black. His next story, Black Ohio man Eric Lindsay has filed a discrimination lawsuit against a convenience store and two police officers after being detained for a white man's shoplifting crime. Lindsay was at a store, and on his way home from work, he went into a store on January 29th, and he walked into the store shortly after a shoplifting incident had occurred. The employees described the suspect as a white man in his 30s that wore a green or gray Carhartt coat with a red hoodie underneath, authorities stated. And that was told to authorities. However, the police stopped a 60-year-old Lindsay, clearly black, wearing a puffy orange coat. Now, the first guy is a white guy in his 30s with a green coat. This guy had on an orange coat. exact opposite. So the body camera footage showed police approaching the Ohio resident and accusing him of stealing, telling him to take his hands out of his pockets. And it also stated that Lindsay suffered humiliation, embarrassment, and severe emotional distress. His attorney, Fannin Rucker, noted that he was the only African-American in the store at the time, and it's the last person they should have stopped. They walked past a dozen or more shoppers, didn't speak to a single one, and went straight to him and started bothering him. The suit expounded on that fact, stating that Lindsay was racially profiled like so many other African Americans in similar incidents around the United States. And the same being as so many national incidents where African Americans have been confronted by law enforcement for engaging in their daily lives and doing nothing, absolutely nothing illegal. The case is about the unsupportable and illegal profiling, detention, accusing, and interrogation of an African-American customer by police officers and the complicit actions of the retail store where it occurred. It also indicated that the manager did nothing to prevent or stop the unconstitutional detention. According to the lawsuit, the officers involved in the incident identified as Tanner and Mitkinball later apologized. They claimed they had made a mistake after learning that another officer had the real shoplifting suspect in custody. They even told Lindsay that he matched the description provided them by the manager, store manager. Finally, the manager apologized for the so-called mix-up. So, Westchester police spokespeople declined to comment because of the pending litigation. It's always the same thing, folks. It's always the same thing, man. You know, it's always the same thing. I'm telling you, boy, these guys just, you know, they just do what they do. Anyway, I'm going to hit you with this part of this story real quick, and I'm probably going to come back to it. So you got Freeway Rick, the real Freeway Rick Ross, enters the boxing world. Freeway Rick Ross doesn't hide his past from, and you know, from stretches a million miles long. At one time, he was the unrivaled drug kingpin of California in the mid-1980s, when an estimated revenue of about $900 million. Drug lord has it that Rick Ross acquired a bounty of $3 million a day at one time. And he was an icon running the rich and famous set until his life and his business turned in 1996, when he was sentenced to life imprisonment. On appeal, Ross's sentence was reduced in September 29th, 2009. He was released from prison. So his life sentence got reduced. And so that was like 10 years after he did 10 years. Anyway, I'm not going to tell you the rest of the story, but I am going to say what he's doing is he's legally promoting fighters. So I'm going to make that, when I do my next story, I'm going to make that the lead story, and then I'll complete that one. I'll complete that. Freeway Rick. Yep, I remember Freeway Rick from L.A. Yes, sir. All right, Freeway Rick, do your thing, man. And Snoop, do your thing. All you people out there that's trying to do the right thing, do it. Own it. That's right, KP's Video News, y'all.